Hi everybody, it's a fan commentary today, I really am a fan of this film. Sometimes I'll do a commentary for a film that, you know, sometimes that might not be the best or might just be middle of the road on sort of thing, but this is a film I absolutely adore. It's John Carpenter's In the Mouth of Madness. Just checking that the commentary in the film were on the same counter number. But the number of times I've seen this film start, I'm so used to watching the entertainment in video, VHS. And I can picture that, the real distinctive, like, like logo, and it's just like a crash sound effect just before the film starts. And I can almost, to me, that logo now is almost part of this sort of film, like, because I've sort of, it's so intertwined there, David Warner. And this is one of those things where, and I think anybody sort of listening to this film who, say, just started college or just, say, starting getting into films and things like that, I think sometimes you just can't predict. And I know, like, now with, like, the internet and things like that, and I guess this was 1994, it came out in 94, but, you know, 94, 95, by the time, say, I saw it or it was coming out on home video and things like that. But you just can't predict like that. I never thought that, like, say, I would write for David Warner's website, I would know somebody who knew David Warner, I would get a tweet off Sandy King Carpenter, John Carpenter's album would come out, and, you know, everybody who worked on the album had worked on this film and things like that. And it's just, I can picture so vividly seeing this movie, and to that point, like, you know, like I say, you know, born in the 70s, you know, 1994, seen tons of movies up to this point, and it was literally like almost being out with a sledgehammer, like, when I saw this movie. And this is, I think, definitely worthy of a mention there. Is this a unique moment in movies? How many films start off with the title of the film and it says coming soon? That's an incredible thing to me. But yeah, sort of, I think, definitely, like, you know, words of encouragement, but, like, anybody out there just sort of listening to this commentary, or who thinks, oh, I wonder if I'd ever get to communicate with or talk to people in the industry. And I never would have thought that, like, when I was a kid growing up, like I say, I know it's all changed now because, like, of things like Twitter and Facebook and email and things like that. But, like, just like the internet was coming in, like, how I would talk to people who, like, there was a guy who lived in Holland who emailed, seems bad, I don't know why, but yeah, he'd seen, like, John Carpenter's Vampires about 3 years before I saw it on Laserdisc, and there were these guys in America who, like, were into movies, and I talked to them about, like, you know, the state of horror in the UK at the time, that all these films were banned, and you're like, how can you be into horror if, like, Texas Chainsaw Massacre's banned and Driller Killer and, like, The Exorcist and all these different things? So yeah, but, like, when I saw this film, and it's so cleverly done, because I've seen this film so many times, but the last two or three times I've watched it, I didn't realise just how almost every line, almost every scene is so cleverly put together that, like, just when I was just setting up the equipment for the commentary, I just noticed that there's a line coming up in a second where Sutter Cane says to John Trent, John Trent says, this is a rotten way to end it, and Sutter Cane says, this isn't the ending, you haven't read it yet. And it made me think, well, if he's not read In the Mouth of Madness at this point, why is he even in the asylum? Why do they think he's gone insane? And then the scene after that is where Bernie Casey, I can't remember his character's name, which is terrible because I've been seeing the film a million times, but he's saying, like, oh, one of our biggest clients, or Kane, is sort of, you know, with their own problems, like this insurance claim and everything. And John Trent's like, oh, he's heard of our Kane, but at the same time, I think there's a line later on where he says, like, well, Sutter Cane, I've basically never heard of him. But then they're saying, oh, Sutter Cane's this amazingly huge author that's massive. And I just kind of like how it's kind of this like loaded thing, but it's almost like a seesaw where it's just constantly going back and forth between what, you know, what you could perceive as, like, if this was just a straight linear film, I think it would still work of, you know, there's this book, and I even did a video about it. It was like a complete fluke thing, just one of those like right place, right time kind of moments, a bit like when I very first saw the film. But when 50 Shades of Grey, the movie, came out recently, I noticed it said Michael DeLuca Productions. Like, somebody was reviewing it, I think it was like, might have been Charlie Brooker or something like that. But either way, anyway, they showed a clip from 50 Shades of Grey. It said Michael DeLuca Productions. And Michael DeLuca wrote this movie. And any time when I just saw, I was like, oh my God, DeLuca, instantly thought of In the Mouth of Madness. And I know I'm like, you know, anybody who's listened to half of any of these commentaries, I love a good coincidence, and I love, like, sort of, you know, try and link things together that aren't really linked. But I just thought, oh, like, even if it was just pure coincidence, or Michael DeLuca deliberately made 50 Shades of Grey the film for this reason. But I did kind of love the fact, though, that 50 Shades of Grey was based on this book. And this book had come out, and there's been all these studies of, like, there's been loads more pregnancies, and, like, you know, because of, you know, shenanigans, you know, people have read the book and things like that, and, you know, all this, like, all this, you know, all these different kinds of clothing and, you know, sex items have been sort of sold. And I thought, even though, like, In the Mouth of Madness is about monsters and things like that, it's still about this really successful book, and I just kind of love that sort of, again, that great juxtaposition of how those two things really sat nice together. And, like, say, just watching it the last couple of times, like, say, just how beautifully it's put together. Just, like, you could literally, like, say, if this was just a quote-unquote, I'm doing air quotes, if this was a normal film and it just literally played out, like, you know, as a normal film would do, I definitely think this could really just work as a straight, you know, ordinary film. But then, playing with the editing, playing with the dialogue, and I was thinking the scenes, like, say, where when he goes to Hobb's End with Styles, and then there's a bit later on where Harglow, Charlton Heston's character, says, we didn't send you no woman, like, you went on your own. And it's like, well, we definitely saw him go with a person, whether it was in his imagination or whether it, you know, whether he, you know, the book has sent him crazy and all this kind of stuff. And so it's kind of like, I love that, because it's like they've literally made it so you could argue this film one way or the other. It's just imagine the whole thing. It's all just fiction. It's all this book. And then, and again, I've only come to realise this more recently. I should really say the origin story first, but been a big, huge, actually, I've got a very tiny bit of a beer and one full can is left. So I'll just get the, I'll just finish this little bit of a beer. Yeah, but been a big Carpenter fan ever since I was, would call myself a film fan, because most people watch films, you know, it's the, you know, when you grow up, everybody gets taken to the cinema, don't they? If we go watch a Disney film or a cartoon or something, and, you know, especially in the home video era and multi-channel TV or just films on TV, it's not that much of a stretch to say people watch films. But when I would start calling myself a film fan, one person, and I think mostly because he had his name above the title, but again, this kind of seesaw thing where I think I did know who John Carpenter was because of, you know, John Carpenter's Halloween, John Carpenter's the thing, but I didn't realize how much I liked John Carpenter movies. Well, you know, you watch Halloween, oh, Halloween, brilliant. You watch, like, The Thing, and I remember I very few times watched The Thing, it was like too scary, I couldn't watch it because I was quite young, that's my excuse anyway. But then, you know, because, like I say, I've said this on a million commentaries, but Talk about a million commentaries there. Smoking, always one of my little ticks there. Smoking in a film, it nearly always means it's okay. Oh, it's they've got more balls than most people, especially nowadays. If you see smoking in a film, they may as well have hardcore pornography on there in terms of the stylistic choices and how people perceive it, because they've demonised it as. And I'm not a smoker, by the way. But anyway, I've said this on loads of commentaries, but like years ago, like I would just go watch films completely randomly, and like I'd go watch anything. And so over the years, I find myself, you know, thinking, well, why did I see Care Bears in the movie twice? Or why, like, case in point, and again, anybody who's listened to any of these commentaries, I don't care, apart from, I don't care how much money a film makes in terms of, you know, if a film's a big flop or a film's a huge success, I just judge it on its merits. But one film that I went to see a couple of weeks ago was called The Finest Hours, a Disney film, and I read today that apparently it's lost like $75 million or something. This was back when $75 million was a lot of money, off the line, off the two of us. But like even now I kind of like that I've still got this tradition of going to see films that are like, you know, that don't do very well or just disappear or whatever. But yeah, so making a long story even longer, to quote Gary Turow, so I just found myself watching all these random films. And one film I went to see at the cinema, and I don't think I knew it was John Carpenter at the time, was Big Trouble in Little China. And so over the years, like say, caught the thing on TV, one of the very first videos I ever brought was John Carpenter's Halloween, because I love the holiday of Halloween, and the, you know, you can just like have a couple of beers, or you know, when you're a kid, you just get a pumpkin, or you know, there might be a spooky film on TV and things like that. So yeah, you know, like say, got to see Big Trouble in Little China at the cinema. Like saying at the time, I don't think, pretty sure I just went to see it. And then, you know, things like They Live, I can remember the people who used to live across the road from me, mum and dad, they'd let me watch films when they like rented, because you know they had quite quite money, and they'd let me watch videos they'd rented. And you know, so when they had Sky satellite TV and things, I could watch films across there, and they rented They Live. And so, you know, and again, I don't know how subconsciously or consciously noticed it was Carpenter, but really loved They Live. Like say, Escape from New York, there was a low budget, but there was a mid-budget video label called Spectrum in the UK, a bit like Channel 5 home video. And I think they released films for like $5.99, but like Cinema Club as well. And one of the very first films I ever got from them was Escape from New York. So yeah, so it's all. And then one of the very first websites I ever went to was the Escape from New York official website. And then, and I've never noticed these until those posters there just by the entrances to that like shopping complex there, or that apartment complex. There's a shot in a second where the windows look really cool in that place. The scene's just being one of the windows, I think that was kind of cool. So over the years, like just getting into John Carpenter, and then like say when I was slowly starting to become aware of who John Carpenter was, and like say really putting the pieces together of like, but like John Trent puts the piece, so it's stretching for coincidence, but so when I started just figuring out that, oh, there's this guy named John Carpenter and he makes all these films, and I didn't realise how much, oh, I really loved Halloween, but blah blah blah, and really loved Escape from New York, really loved like all these different films. And so, and then I realised John Carpenter is like probably one of my favourite directors. And then, and again, this was just before the internet, or you know, just about that same time when the internet was starting to get as a thing that quote unquote normal people would have. I remember going through my local Odeon and just seeing the poster for In the Mouth of Madness, and it said like John Carpenter's In the Mouth of Madness. And I don't know at the time if I'd heard anything about it other than the title. I'm sure this was like a Thursday or a Friday or something like that. And for whatever reason, I didn't go see it then, but I went to see it either the next day or the day after. And like I said, when it, you know, obviously mid-90s, so by this point, I've seen so many films, you know, for all different genres, all different decades, and all these different kinds of things. But still to this day, I can remember walking back from the cinema and just being like, that was amazing. and in terms of just the structure of the film, but the actual concept of, like I say, even, you know, no, I'm not taking anything away from this film, but like I say, just the concept of there's this book that sends you crazy, they've turned this book into a film, you just watch that film. And I can remember, like I say, when it very first started, this film, like I say, when I was talking about people smoking, and to me it's like, you know, check, that's cool. J&B, again, Carpenter thing, you know, check, cool. You know, tick even, you know, checking it off on the list. But like, you know, or somebody uses a payphone, I don't know why, it instantly just catches my attention. It's like, oh, that's cool, that's cool. But yeah, so when I was watching this film, it was literally almost like, literally, if I got like a bingo card in front of me or some kind of like, you know, like writing like an amazing film, it's like, yeah, it's John Carpenter. Oh, the music's, you know, hard rock, and I got into hard rock in about like 92, 93, you know, 91, 92. So it was in the peak of like my sort of interest in like, you know, buying rock magazines, going to rock concerts and things like that. So it's like, oh my God, John Carpenter's done like a rock score. I'd say it was horror. So that's when I suddenly started really getting into horror, when I suddenly sort of realised who John Carpenter was. You know, people like Charlton Heston, who's on screen now, and things like that. So this was literally almost like I said, I remember Saturday afternoon, there were about four people in the cinema. I remember I was roughly, you know, roughly in the middle, you know, like middle row, roughly middle seat, you know, there or thereabouts. And I remember so excited about, because at the time, yeah, there was no, in my hometown there was no cinema, but in the town just across, a bit like I was saying, in the town just across was another cinema. I remember walking back from there, and on Saturday afternoon I remember getting some chips on the way back for take up to my parents' house, we had a chippy dinner. But I remember just the whole way walking back from the cinema to my parents' house, and even now, if I ever walk that same route again, I still occasionally think of, oh, when I was walking back from In the Mouth of Madness, and just thinking, oh, that's incredible. Because it was like, and I don't like practical jokes. I think, you know, more often than not, they're quite cruel, and I've never really understood about, like, why would you jump out on somebody, or why would you, you know, like, draw a fake mustache on? Oh, it's hilarious. No, but I've never really liked practical jokes. But to me, it was like having a great practical joke played on you, the fact that, because at that point, when you've realised that, like, and obviously it's a film, it's fiction and everything, but when you realise that you've got to that point where you've watched a film where the main point of the story of the film is that there's this book that they've turned into a film, and the book and the film send people crazy. But you've, by the time you've found out that bit of information, you've seen the film, so you can't knock on what scene you can't unsee. Like George Miller, and that guy, oh, the guy with the mobile phone, I never noticed that. Oh, that's funny, actually. But that's like another thing, though, as well, where, again, like, you know, anybody who's listened to like any, you know, any of these commentaries or any conversation I've had, or any Twitter post or message board post or anything like that, like, is sort of that, like, one of my big bugbears is that people don't think CGI started until like 2 weeks ago. People don't think mobile phones existed, you know, late, you know, earlier than like 2002 or something like that. So, like, you know, like things like this, like, you know, this is like 94, was probably filmed in 93 years ago, the mobile phone there, you know. But like there, when she's saying like there, I think this is the part where, you know, like she's saying, oh, you know, well, I think it's just been always saying, oh, you know, sells more than Stephen King, and he's basically never heard of this guy. And I guess, you know, if you're not really into horror and stuff, or, you know, there's certain authors that are completely, well, that's another thing though as well, I think it's quite funny how certain things have like got this popularity, but they're popular in like loads of different ways. Like someone like a Lee Child, who wrote or writes the Jack Reacher novels. Like, if you ever, you know, go to his website, or, you know, the people who publish the Jack Reacher novels, they always say how successful the Jack Reacher novels are. And, you know, they've made the Tom Cruise movies and everything. And I really, you know, like, I read Personal, and I saw Jack Reacher, and I'm looking forward to the new Jack Reacher film. It's called Never Back Down, I think it's called. And I'm really looking forward to it. Well, if you ever see anybody who's posted a clip of a Lee Child interview or a clip from a Jack Reacher film, like, the numbers are really low. And there's this huge author. And I'm really surprised, because I've watched some of these interviews with Lee Child. They're really interesting. And I think I saw one where it's Lee Child, funnily enough, was interviewing Stephen King, or, you know, a conversation with Stephen King. And I think it was 100 views or 200 views or something like that. You're like, wow, you think you'd be way more than that. And I kind of love, in a way, that there is this kind of, I'm there saying, oh, why would you know who sort of came was? But then again, that said, there, I think a lot of people say, who's Lee Child? And be like, I don't know. And he's sold millions and millions of novels all around the world and things like that. And I'm just going to open my beer. And that weather up there, that's another thing as well, that I think the production design on this is incredible, because I saw somebody on eBay the other day selling all the novels and of the kind of fake, I think from what I can gather, it's just the same page printed over and over again in these novels. But the cover design's incredible, and that standee that says Arcane. I mean, imagine having that. You could just put your videos in, or books or something. He sees you. Oh, God. Sort of Cane fans. Yeah, but that's another thing, though, as well. And I'm never sure. I feel like I have seen it, and then I feel like I've just imagined it. But if there was a novel to this film, how perfect would that be? Again, I don't think there was. I think it's probably Tempting Fate a little bit too much. I'm not sure. But how great. And again, I don't think they can do this from a legal standpoint. But if they could have said it was written by Sutter Cane and a little asterisk and Alan Foster, whoever it was or something, that would have been really cool. Oh, that cigarette lighter there is quite good as well. It's like the Man with the Golden Guns. But yeah, and I don't know what it is as well. Probably says a lot about my old brain. But I've always loved films where Videodrome, I think's one, and where they sort of play with what people think and how people react to different things. Because I think again, that's something that's so personal. Again, to coin a phrase, the name of the Jack Reacher novel that I read, but. In the sense that it's one of those things where I think everybody at some point has thought what's the meaning to life and how big is the universe and all these different things. And I think everybody, especially when you're a kid, you think do I see colours the same as other people? When I look green, is it the green how I perceive it to be? And this is nothing though as well, again, it's talking about movies and music and things like that. But I am constantly amazed at how many times I've seen a movie, and even people that I've known for years, and literally sometimes basically my whole life, or even people who went to college with, or whoever it may be, and I thought, oh, they will watch this film and get the exact same reaction I will. Or you'll go online and say, I've just watched the new Ghostbusters trailer, and that's causing a huge storm on the internet, and I personally think it was good. But and you think, well, obviously there's trolls and things like that. And I was in a discussion about Planet of the Apes, the Tim Burton Planet of the Apes movie, and I personally think it's a great movie, nothing wrong with that film, and people hate that film. And it's really fascinating to see what people like, how people perceive things. And again, you've got to take things with a grain of salt, and you've got to think, well, especially sometimes you read it online, or some people taking the mic, or some people being serious. And then with this film, again, that extra layered quality about this film, anybody who says they're a Carpenter fan instantly just goes up a couple of notches in my book. But the one, this is again a classic, but again, this is a film that's so intelligent, so clever, so well put together, and then they've done I was just imagining, not really, and then he wakes up again, brilliant. It's such a kind of, it's such a sort of, again, a sort of, that's the thing, that's the kind of thing you'd see in and again, I'm not going to go because I love these movies, but that's something you'd see in Friday 13th, 12 or something, Yeah, but like, yeah, so if people know who John Carpenter is, I'm like, oh, brilliant. And then, like, then I've seen a few people have started reviewing this online. I think it's probably giving me a kick up the ass to do the commentary. But anybody who knows what this film is, or, like I say, most people who've seen it seem to quite like it, or seem to, get the kind of, some people are just like, oh, it's rubbish or whatever. But again, it's that kind of, I love that thought of, like, what do people think? And people have noticed little bits or certain little things. You just have to zoom in on that text if it does the same page over and over again. Yeah, but when people talk about this film, I'm always really fascinated to sort of see what they thought. I'm just looking at some of the stuff there because I'm so, again, so used to watching that, the VHS. And that's the what's funny. Just behind me, I might be good to take a photograph of more. Put a picture of somewhere in this commentary on the website sectrex.co.uk. But yeah, I've got the video behind me, I've got the laser disc, and I've got the soundtrack recorded in Knob World. Yeah, anybody who's seen this film, I just kind of, it's like being part of, like, it is almost like Sutter Cane is like part of a secret club or something, because I do think that it is, and again, this is that thing about, like, 90s films as well, where if somebody said to me, complete knee-jerk reaction, what's your favourite time period for movies? It is, it's that, you think, oh, 80s, it's like this, that, and the other, like Karate Kid, Crawl, and, Ghostbusters and everything, so it's kind of all these, like, But then the more I think about it, it's like 90s stuff, like, it's like this, like, say, if somebody said all time, in all seriousness, like, say, because they say, I do love all different kinds of films. Like, say, anybody's listening to these commentaries, like, say, I've stuck up for, because I do genuinely love them. Like, say, something like Carmen, Your Convenience, I genuinely think that's an amazing movie. It's so funny. It's, and again, layered. It's kind of got all these elements to it. And, even like I did a Jaws the Revenge commentary, and, even though I love that film, I can kind of see, maybe, it is what it is, kind of thing. And, and I've, even like the Phantom Menace has grown on me and things like that over the years. Well, I never really 100% hate it, but it's grown on me and grown on me and grown on me and things like that. So, yeah, so sometimes though, if you've got like a bit of, like, I always think my shtick almost is like, I'm the guy that, like, I like everything, like, kind of thing. So sometimes I think it can rub people up the wrong way. And, like, if I suddenly start saying, In the Mouth of Madness is one of my favourite films. If I've done a commentary saying I love Jaws the Revenge, people are like, oh yeah. But I say, in all seriousness, that, like, say, I know sometimes my taste in movies could be all over the place, and I do genuinely give, like, a cut a lot of slack for films that don't really, resonate with a lot of people and things like that. But if somebody said to me, what are the top 10 films you've ever seen in your entire life? And I just do it purely on, like, the script, how it was directed, technically, emotionally, perfect movies. And it is like Coin on a Scat Seat, Clockwork Orange, this. It really is, like, it always ping pongs between those three films, really. If somebody said to me, like, you're best of the best of the best of the best, and it's like, say, Clockwork Orange, when I saw that, mind blower. Like, it really was like, this doesn't get much better than that. When I saw Coin on a Scat Seat, mind blower, perfect, 80s movie. If I'm going to fit into the 80s is the best decade to me. It's a lot, if you say Coin on a Scat Seat, I don't think it gets, like, say, it's probably one of the best eight technical, from a technical level, one of the best 80s films. And I say, just films that I've seen, that could actually be interesting from each decade. One of my favorite films, like, from the 20s, would probably be Cabin of Dr. Caligari. And then, yeah, but like 90s, and just again, just as a whole, In the Mouth of Madness is just something else. I mean, like, say, I mean, I know I'm sort of, again, I like a lot of great shot there, but again, like, say, that scare, that jump scare, just gonna have another sip. That's very similar to the shot in Halloween, think about it. Yeah, but that's another great shot there. It's just all complete darkness all around him. Actually, I was thinking about that when me and my dad were talking about fog, the film and the concept, well, the weather, I should say. But yeah, I was walking across the house where I saw they live at on video, from the people who across the road from me. There was a big, huge field behind them, and it was dead foggy. It was like a Tuesday or Wednesday morning. I don't know why I was at school, and they'd closed school because there was fog and nobody could find it. But I remember just walking across that field and getting to a point in the middle of the field where I realised I was surrounded by fog. I couldn't see anything to the left or right, forward or back, or looking up. The only thing I could see was just the grass on the floor below me. But it just kind of just put me in mind of that, just seeing that shot. But yeah, that with this film as well, because just say the concept is great, the execution's great, the acting's great, the effects are great. But again, I love that like playfulness, that like that scene where he wakes up, and I'm one of the few people on earth that like, you know, if even if at the end of this he woke up said it was just a dream, I'm like, oh, that's quite funny. I think I'm one of the few people. It's such a lazy way of writing, but it's just a dream. But like that scare where he'd been reading the book and he woke up, you think, oh, you know, and then he wakes up again. That's such a cheap, like, I don't want to use the word cheap, but it's such a kind of, like, say, it's something you'd see in, like, you know, some crazy horror sequels or some low budget or, you know, not very creative movie. But then there's a line in this where he says, never, never throw chips at a driver. And I don't know why, it's always just a line that's stuck with me from this film, because, you know, it's just like, again, it's that, like, you know, it's such a great film, and it's like, and it seems such a, you know, no pun intended, just a throwaway line, but this was nothing as well. Come on, what message board it was on, or where it was. I think it was Reddit, I think. It must have been. It may have been Twitter. Like, those two things are completely different, so I don't know why I'm confusing the two, but I was talking to somebody, and they said they knew the person who was the person on that bike. And again, I've heard a few people say that, like, that's so, like, again, like, you know, I think, like, when you've seen loads of films, and when you know, you think, oh, you know, I've been watching films 20, 30 years or whatever, and it's still an effective scene. It really is. And again, it's what it puts me in mind of is Texas Chainsaw Massacre a little bit, because there's a quote-unquote famous scene from Texas Chainsaw Massacre where it's about 20 minutes into it, and I was looking at it, the point of no return scene in Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And there's another film, what film was it now? But there's a film where I remember it being one point where it goes to night, and I remember thinking, one of the few times I felt claustrophobic, I remember thinking, and I'm surprised the name of the film escapes me. I was watching something the other day and they couldn't think of something, why can't I remember it? But yeah, this film, and I remember thinking at the time, this is not good in terms of, for the characters in this film, lack of the power cables there. I remember thinking, this game over for people in this film. But what this reminds me of, just as they go across the bridge into Rob's End, and when you see, like, as if they're floating on the clouds, like I say, there's a quote-unquote famous scene in Texas Chainsaw Massacre where, I say, it's about 20 minutes in, I think, I'll have to check it just for, I'm going to put it on the website, but where Daniel Pearl, the cinematographer, had overexposed the scene, and you couldn't see nothing through the windows, it was just white. Like, there was literally, like, and it's a mistake, and I don't like pointing out movie mistakes, but it was a mistake. They didn't mean to do it. But I always look at that scene now since I've had it pointed out to me, and to me, that's the part where they are completely screwed. They are dead. and again, this film, again, because it's been like Total Recall style, it's been put together in such a way that you could legitimately make a case for, he's just crazy, he's imagining all this, it's a dream, the book is sending people crazy, this is the film of the book, blah blah blah. There's a million different permutations in a million different ways you could argue this film. But if you just are taking this film as sort of, you know, if you just are taking it like the very first two or three times you watch this film, you know, if you are the kind of person that will give this film another go, this is the point where you sort of think, I think, if you're just taking it as a straight linear movie, which it's not, but if you do take it as that, again, it's a bit like a Dawn of the Dead type thing where you can literally layer it, you know, it's just a zombie film, which is a bit film about consumerism and what would people do in that situation, blah, blah, blah. But that, to me, this is the point of no return scene now in terms of, because that's, again, what's funny about that as well, because I noticed in the credits it's Rob Coleman, who's one of the effects people in this, and Rob Coleman's the guy from from Puppets to Pixels, the documentary on Attack of the Clones. I think today they've announced it. There's a documentary called the road to the Force Awakens or something like that. And that's, I think that's going to premiere somewhere. I think, oh, that's going to be on the DVD. But yeah, Rob Coleman is the effects guy, and that's such a great effect there, like a bit of like little bit of CG there. And again, like say, you know, I always think of this car as well. Reminds me of some of you like the car you'd see in like X-Files or something like that. Yeah, so that this point here is like sort of to me is like where, like now this is like game over, man. Like, you know, it's kind of like, you know, that, like now they're in Hobb's end. It's like they found it, but like say this is the scene where this is like I say, oh, oh that's been enjoying your stay. Well, no, great, it would be that time you got it. Yeah, but this is the scene where. Because we've seen all these scenes where he's with Styles. I love that them bridges like that. You know, because again, this is a Carpenter thing where, oh, that's the thing I was going to say actually. When they play the Carpenters, we've only just begun. Again, how great is that? But with John Carpenter, because I'm so used to seeing now the name John Carpenter. Like, if I ever see the word Carpenter on anything, I instantly think of John Carpenter. So if you see any credits like Head Carpenter, I'm like, oh, was it John Carpenter? And, oh, when they play the Carpenters, and again, this is not just not in much street cred, but the Carpenters are brilliant. Like, I really love the Carpenters. So when they play the Carpenters in a John Carpenter film, it's like, oh, that's just perfect. But yeah, that car just like to me, it's like the perfect car because again, it's this thing about this beautiful quality of this film where it just. Everything is like, and always like they're wearing cowboy boots. I remember when used to wear cowboy boots, and I used to think, it's oh, I'm like John Trent, but yeah, it's got this like that street in like everything. But that's another thing I was going to say. So, about John Carpenter films, and again, I was just because watching like things like this over and over again, and Halloween over and over again, and you know, and Christine over and over again, and things like that. But there's certain things now that I almost don't think exist in real life, only in John Carpenter films. So, if you ever see like a petrol station or an underpass under a bridge or that bridge thing they drove across, if I ever see one of them in something else other than in a John Carpenter film, I'm like, oh yeah, John Carpenter films them. I've heard a few people say this online as well, and I honestly don't think it would work. It's a great idea in principle. But people said it would have been better if all these people had been from Stephen King films. This is a great, like, you know, pullback sort of reveal, like, and it focuses, it takes focus, and that boom, perfect. But that, again, the axe thing that, like, you know, again, it's got that, like, it's so original, and it's so out there, it's so crazy. But like they're like the jump scare, the playful lines, the axe, you know, it's like, and that's another thing though as well, because like at the time I had no idea who H.P. Lovecraft was. And again, that's something I know, it says more about my personality than a lot of people, but people that have got this reputation for being really out there, like H.P. Lovecraft or the film producer John Peters or Norman Wexler who wrote Staying Alive or Philip K. Dick and that conservatory there, I'll mention that in a second, but yeah, I love people that have like, or the KLF or something like that, people that have got this reputation for just being really different and unique and not even like, I think some quote-unquote artists like I'm crazy or I'm really, these people were just the real deal, like, you know, like that, like, you know, they weren't doing it for a reputation, most people don't know who they are. I really really love people like that, and again, it's just this film is loaded with that, like, you know, because like I said, I didn't know H.P. Lovecraft was, but you know, just reading about him, and he's got all this like kind of, you know, all this great paranoia and everything, and you know, like not great, you know, because I think anybody, if you've ever been a bit paranoid, you're like, oh god, but you know, so he's like, yeah, anybody, it's not a, and then like, you know, Mrs. Pittman there, though, she's like the sweet old lady from like the Karate Kid and stuff, and like, you know, it's like, oh my god, so it's like say, but that conservatory there, just on the side of the Pittman Hotel. I'll have to try and take a picture of it. I'll stand next to it with my In the Mouth of Madness laser disc or something. But yeah, that every time I walk past it, there's a church with like a little bit of like a conservatory on the side, and it just always reminds me of it. I'm sure if we put a picture side by side, or if I take a picture and look at it with the film, it's completely different. But I don't think I've walked past it without thinking of In the Mouth of Madness, when you see she's turned into the creature and she's there. And again, this thing as well, when they look through the window and there's the church there. And when I found out that that was a real church, it was like, it's like, again, I've tried, when I do a lot of these commentaries, I can't, and with a film like this, like I say, as you can probably tell, I've been talking virtually non-stop for 40 minutes. So it's like, I don't really need to do very much, excuse me, say, I don't really need to do any research for this film in terms of like, you know, facts and trivia and things like that, although I haven't really talked about the laser system video very much, so I'll do that in a second. But yeah, I can't see the point of just going on IMDb and going, well, you know, this church is real. But I think it is definitely worthy of mention, because that church just looks like a proper, you know, either an addition to a real building or some kind of stop motion kind of thing. Oh, that's such a, this is reality. That didn't sound as good as I wanted it to. I was trying to do the term, this is real. Yeah, but when you find out that church is real, and I know, that's something I only noticed the other day, is there's those like ducks there on the I think it's a duck and a dog. But yeah, this is like one of those films where, that like, again, like watching it in, like I said, so used to watching the VHS, because I must have watched the VHS 30 times or something, probably more than that. But so now watching it in like widescreen, or like when I've watched the Laserdisc before the Laserdisc player went crazy, and I have to get that sorted or get a new one. But yeah, so I'm so used to seeing a 4:3 version that, like, now, I mean, that's like such an incredible stuff. Oh my god, that's a real thing. If I saw that, I'd probably just die. Yeah, but that's another thing as well, because there's a new newspaper started in the UK, which is incredible. When 2016, I think this is the longest I've gone on a commentary without getting the symptoms of a beer. There's a new newspaper started in the UK called New Day. It's been going for about a couple of weeks. But one thing that always makes me laugh on the video box, I've got to reach behind myself here. But like a Mudbone, when he's gone, oh, who put the mic stand back there? I'm old man, I can't reach for things. But on the VHS box, which I'm just holding in my hand, there's a quote from an old newspaper, which is a weird segue again, the ping pong back and forth. But it says, the slimy thing's excellent today. And that was nothing though as well. When I say, when I was just sort of getting ready for the commentary, it got a property news magazine, like just a free magazine, and you know, for like the literary paper and stuff like that. But there's a quote on it, says, they'd be mad to miss it. And then the quote on the quote from the star on the cover is, you'd be mad to miss it on this VHS. So that's kind of a nice little, like, literally, it's just like there next to you, I can see this magazine, and it's got virtually the same quote on. But the best film of Carpenter's career. I can't make. Well, that's kind of reflecting a bit weird, faded as well. $12.99. But what's interesting about this, I don't know if it's just a frame rate thing, but it says 91 minutes on the VHS, and on this file that I'm watching, it says 95. So I can't remember it seeing. No, I'm so surprised, like I was with that. What does it say on the old Laserdisc? 91 minutes, CLV, two sides. Wonder where we are now. I'm looking at the chapter stops for the Laserdisc, and it is, we've gone past the Pittman Hotel, the Black Church. Styles Come Clean. Styles Comes Clean is the next one. It was partly a hoax. Get a Sutter Cane lunchbox. Jürgen Prochnow, though. The bad guy from Beverly Hills Cop 2. And the bad guy from Ghostbusters 2, that's funny, thinking about it. I always think as well, those kind of, like, certain kind of dog, and again, I must have said this on commentaries before, but one thing, you know, I love movies, some things are like, ooh, these dogs are evil. Like, I'd love to see a film where one of those dogs, and I can never think Dobermans or Rottweilers, I was confused, I didn't hear Dobermans, right? Doberman Pinchers? Pincers?
Stewie Green impression. Gonna ride if I'm wearing a dog. No, world's worst impression of Stewie Green there. But Stewie Griffin, even for his slip for our regular listeners. But get a film with one of those dogs and a cat and make it like the sweetest, get it and a spider and that was a funny thing though as well. This was one of those perfect in the mouth of madness lattice of coincidence clutching at straws thing. But I saw, I think it was the name Oliver Harper, I think. I hope I'm getting the name right, but he's did a YouTube thing saying he's doing a retrospective of In the Mouth of Madness, and he posted this video on Mother's Day, and it made me think, I haven't watched In the Mouth of Madness for a while, I watched In the Mouth of Madness, and it was about like 20 minutes into it, I was like, there's that line where she says, it's Mother's Day, and I was like, I'm watching this on Mother's Day, it was like, whoa, man. And I got the old soundtrack here. What's funny, I'd be interested to do it. Oh, well, I'm just wondering how many chapters is there? There's 28 chapters and 23 tracks on the CD. What's interesting though, I noticed this just when I was looking at the tracks, but the last track is called Just a Bedtime Story. And that, again, is it just like a myth? Is it just a part of a book? Is it just a book? I mean, again, I've literally never thought about it until just, but wouldn't that be, oh my God, I've just, if it was just you saw a shot at the end of somebody just reading a book and they close the book and put it on the shelf, oh my dear Lord, wonder where we are soundtrack wise, the picture changes, the black church, oh that's funny, you're wrong, Trent, Mommy's dead, I think, Styles Comes Clean and You're Wrong, Trent, is where we are. And I noticed as well, it's digital. So COVID doesn't mess around. But that's something as well I've noticed. I love John Carpenter. Seems to be really cool when there's a direct collaboration with somebody as well, because like this is John Carpenter and Jim Lang. And John Carpenter and Alan Elworth, I mean, I love the soundtrack to Halloween 2, like, you know, one of the best things ever, you know, just like, you've got a great soundtrack anyway, and then just knocks out the park, and then, you know, I think he wrote Ghosts of Mars, and They Live with the same guy, and they've got this quirky quality to them, so, yeah, it's cool. Yeah, some really interesting, like, just noticing, like, there was like a peacock or something. Never seen the same one in the toilet. Oh, chess. God, you know, I do love this film. But it's those demo switches before. But again, this is that thing where saying just how this film has just got so many great scenes and great elements, but like, oh, there, you could tell that's a picture you just moved, but this is a great shot here. But like, if she's got like a husband chained to it, and it's such a great like it's one of those perfect, like, again, if this just was like a really short film, just that scene of him walking down, seeing the weird picture, and then smoking indoors, and then seeing like a really sweet old lady with, and this is the thing as well where, again, you could say he's crazy, he's just imagining the whole thing, but if you were just taking this again as a straight movie, she saw him with style, that pretty little thing he just came in with, so providing he's not crazy, which he very well could be, and the thing is he's not acting crazy, so this is the great thing, and this is what's perfect about this movie, so stylistically clever that, like, if you ever seen a film where somebody's crazy but the everything they are saying from a logical perspective, Sam Neill is so, or John Trent, I should say, John Jay, is like, if you were looking at this analytically, he has nothing wrong. He has gone, you know, he fell asleep in the car, they turned up in Hobb's End. Styles is the woman from Arcane. So, and that's nothing as well. I think the sign of a really good film is, apart from Bernie Casey's character name, I can remember loads of the character names, loads of the names for like Arcane and things like that, and I always think loads of films, if I've seen them, like, say sometimes there'll be a film like,
I can't think of an example, but sorry, I would say something like Krull or something like that. As much as I love Krull, I can barely name any of the characters in Krull. And I remember texting Tom once and saying that, like, when I'm watching Krull, I was thinking everything in Krull is called Krull. I think the planet's called Krull, the thing he throws is called Krull, the man's named Krull. So it's like, you know, and I don't go, I love Krull, it's amazing. But yeah, I'll tell you what, if John Trent's having a beer, I'll look virtual reality and have a sip of my tea. But yeah, that's, so if you look at this analytically and like completely logically, if you're just saying that, oh, that's a great shot there, and that's nothing as well, shooting at night, I'm always fascinated by it since getting into filmmaking more than when I was at college studying film, which is a ridiculous thing to say. But I just want to go, I don't know if I can say it now, but yeah, but a few people have said that they thought it'd be better if they were Stephen King characters, like if that dog was Cujo and things like that, maybe these kids were from Firestarter or something, and it's... it's a great idea, but I'm dead glad they didn't go that route. But, yeah, so, like, if you go with the option that he's crazy, then it's as much of a muchness if he's crazy, you're just imagining this. But then, if you go with it that, like, he fell asleep in the car, he woke up in Hobb's End, he was with that woman's ran away. Mrs. Pittman acknowledged that she saw that woman, excuse me, so he didn't just imagine it, and this is a great, this again, not... No, a cheap scare, but again, it's playing with the like when he opens that door, there's nobody there, and then she dives through it and stuff like that. And I kind of love stuff like that where it's kind of again, and just watching it more recently, and really, and I think it was literally not the last time I watched it, but the time before, I think it was because I hadn't seen it for a bit. I think I watched it sober, and I was noting all the little edits, and from what I can gather, they really took a lot of time editing this movie. And again, from a purely and this is probably something in my old brain that's a bit out there, but I think the only way that you can logically analyze something, again, my taste in music is crazy, my taste in movies is crazy, my taste in food is all over the place, but again, if somebody said to me, and serious, and you know, like I say, anytime I've done these commentaries, you know, whether people believe me or not, I do love all these films I've done commentaries for, and I genuinely love all these crazy hair metal bands that I like and stuff like that. But if somebody said to me, on a pure technical level, what's the best music, and it's like, you know, Wagner, Ride of the Valkyries, is probably my favourite technically brilliant piece of music. Like I say, you said, watch the best film you've ever seen. It's like, say, things like Kunaskatsi, Clockwork Orange, and this. And like I say, my favourite bass player, Billy Sheehan. Like I say, great technique and emotion, but super technical and spot on the money. Johnny on the spot, I've nothing I can do. Don't know why I'm just singing Mr. Big there. Again, not very fashionable thing to... I love Mr. Big. Mr. Big's cool. Anyway, but... yeah, from a pure technical perspective, is that the editing on this film is top notch. This reminded me as well. I think this was 94, and I think the album was 95, I think. It might even be 94, I can't remember, but Music for the Guilty Generation, The Prodigy, starts off with the sound of a typewriter and a voice going, take my work back on the ground, stop it falling in the wrong hands, and it was like, oh, it's the same. When about Guilty Generation and this? Oh my god. But, yeah, playing Guilty Generation, breaking into. I'm gonna do that later on. I know what I'm gonna do this afternoon. I need more beer. Yeah, I wonder if this would sync up with Guilty Generation. I wonder how much of Guilty Generation you could play at the same time. Yeah, but the editing, and like I said earlier on, the dialogue is so, so perfect that, like, I can see now why. And it puts me in mind of when George Lucas talking about, like, Rob Coleman being on that documentary for Attack of the Clones, but it reminds me of watching the making of The Beginning on it. It's called Beginning. That was a great documentary that's on the Phantom Menace DVD when you first see George Lucas and everybody watching a rough cut of The Phantom Menace. They said, this can sound a normal person crazy because of how
you know, the pod race and everything. But I can see now, looking at it, why this film is just a quote-unquote normal person watching this if you're not like a fan of horror or weird films or just films that are a little bit out there. And then that, just that style of writing that, like, a bit like a John Trent says, it, you know, affects people, but like in the sense that because they have deliberately worded things in such a way that realistically or in reality, this is reality, it doesn't make sense. So that's, in a lot of ways, it's kind of like, again, like a perfect movie, because it's like, you, if people say, this doesn't make sense, it kind of doesn't. I managed to flick beer on my nose. Oh, is it? He's turned into a razor head. Yeah, this shot here, like, say, it's such a cheap... Not, again, I keep using the word cheap, but it's like... Because it's kind of like, well, he's looked through the door, there's nobody there, boom, somebody there. I mean, he could obviously... And I've always thought that about acting, though. Well, again, I don't think that gets nowhere near enough credit, but if you're acting on a set that's noisy, or if you've got, like, puppeteers in the background, or I've noticed scenes with animals in, and you've got, like, loads of people clicking things for, so the animal will react or look at something... And I always think that must be a weird thing to do as an actor. Now, you know, I've done a little bit, like, in some, you know, little bits of filmmaking I've done, but where you have to, like, ignore something that you can really see in your vision is a very weird skill to kind of do. So that's it. Or is it from that side? I think seeing those dimmer switches then, but the one I love about stuff like that though as well, because like, you know, you see them dimmer switches and then like there, there's probably like loads of people turning all the lights down all at once. That'd be a great picture of that. Like, I'd like to have the picture where it's completely normal or the completely weird one. People are like, what the hell's that? And I thought that was a good line as well though there. Again, that's like almost like that point of no return thing, but I love that, like, where, like, for the most part he's been this, like, kind of, you know, sort of, you know, quite straight laced. I know something that's how they painted him out in the film, to be this, like, you know, I can spot a fraud and all this kind of stuff. But I kind of love that though, that like the, like, sort of like there, he's just kind of starting, you see him getting a bit like, oh, where we are chapter wise. Harbour Hotel, I assume, no way out. And do you like my ending, maybe? As long as central. I'm to this DRG Recordings Incorporated, 130 West 57th Street, New York, New York. Can't got a fax number on there. I can't remember last time I took this little booklet out. Oh my god! Ah, oh, there's a picture of John Carpenter! John Carpenter, right, discusses a scene with Julie Carmen and Sam Neill. Oh, I hope you could put that on the old side. Original score by John Carpenter and Jim Lang. Synthesizers, samples, voices, John Carpenter and Jim Lang. Guitar on Robbie's office, John Carpenter. Sound design, synthesizer, program, percussion, Jim Lang. Recording credits for track one. Guitar solo, Dave Davies. Guitar, Josh Scala. Bass guitar, Dennis Blaufield. Drums, Mike Baer. Synthesizers, John Carpenter and Jim Lang. What's always really terrible, because like I said, I've been into John Carpenter for a long time. When I reviewed, but when I reviewed Lost Highway, I can remember really easy it was... John Carpenter and Cody Carpenter, obviously, but then there's always the third guy that I can't remember. It's kind of like, is it Dave? Because Dave Davies is the guy from the Kinks. I'm sure the other guy is Daniel Davies, I think, is the other guy from Lost Themes. Oh, he's not a dick. But again, this is one of those. I think one of the very first times I saw it, I think, was on talking about like horror, like cheap horror sequels, but was on, I think, Nightmare on Elm Street 4, where they looped footage and they kept getting out of the cinema and back in again, and I think got a pizza or something like that. But yeah, this scene where he's trying to get away from Hobbs, and I really loved, so it's just like, and it kind of reminds me a little bit of, I think there's a shot of Plan 9 where you see light coming from a town, and there's a John Carpenter that worked on Plan 9, funny enough, and that was another funny thing. I did tweet the picture, but I didn't get no response for that. But there's like, I think anybody who's a John Carpenter fan knows how much John Carpenter loves westerns and things like that, but he's never made a western, which is kind of really ironic and stuff, because like Kurt Russell's made about three and stuff, so it would have been a perfect thing. But I was watching a western the other day, what was it called, The Man Who Shot Wild Bill Hickok or something like that, but it's written by and produced by and starred a guy named John Carpenter, and I was just like, oh, that's brilliant. And I knew instantly that it wasn't the same John Carpenter, but again, it was that real playfulness of like thinking, oh, this is John Carpenter. But would have, and I think unfortunately he's passed, the other John Carpenter, the western John Carpenter, isn't around anymore, but it would have been perfect to get John Carpenter to make a film with that John Carpenter. It's not a Turtle Woman. Again, it's a little short film, looks really crazy out of context. Let me finesse this day. Do there's about 10 little 1 minute clips of this film and say, can you guess what this film's about? Anybody want to be like, what? But even that is like such a great like sort of concept of like, you know, just always some cues I'm going to swallow. And but again, it's got that thing of like, you know, like there, you've got a scene where you don't see very often, like somebody punching a woman in the face, which is crazy. And then you've got like the scene you've seen a million times of like, oh, I'll start a car with like a screwdriver. You're like, oh yeah. And the townsfolk, I love how the townsfolk are walking really slow. But even that again is like such a sort of a great choice stylistically, that like they're not like they are this angry mob, but at the same time just walking really slow and not really saying anything. And again, I think it's just this like very deliberate, very cleverly done, but at the same time you don't notice it the first 100 times you watch the film. It's just like there, like if you ever seen an angry mob that's just walking slowly with like pitchforks and stuff, it's kind of like, what? Ah, smoking the man at four is really strange. I'm thinking about it while talking about Rob Coleman is worked on this, and Hayden Christensen is in this film too. So he's got this like payphone. Oh my god, this it has got everything. I fully forgot about the payphone sequence. So it just, I remember it's coming on a New England telephone, but that's interesting about that because I think you might have mentioned New England. So that's, again, but it's got this like kind of, obviously you would never remember a fact like that probably if this happened in real life. But actually, I think you might have mentioned somewhere about New England when he's trying to find the town again. But yeah, it kind of nails it to the specific point. That's just kind of cool. And again, that's such a great scene there that, like, you know like I say, I don't want you to put this reaction like IMDb trivia, but it was like a contortionist with like a face mask on upside down. But it's such a great, again, you know, I don't mind CGI or like some really elaborate effect. But, you know, obviously, if you're a contortionist, you don't learn how to do that overnight. But I kind of like the, sometimes you think, how did they do that? You're looking for something like really, oh, is it like a mechanical model or something, or is it like, you know, some kind of photo effect? And it's like, no, it's just a person. Like, and what I love about stuff like this, because again, I don't know if it's just like over the years watching, say, films with like my parents and stuff, or just watching films with other people, where, and you have to constantly use your brain to sort of be like, sort of, you know, like say Halloween 2 is a perfect example, where why is nobody in this hospital? Why is this happening? Why is that? You're like, you know, you're like clutching at straws for try and find a reason. And I always remember there's a part in the Blair Witch where it's like, again, it's this like dividing line, seesaw sort of thing, when they're trying to get out of the woods
and they literally can't. It's like, you know, they're just walking in a straight line, and they keep like repeating themselves and stuff. But again, I kind of love this, because if you're watching it with, say, somebody who doesn't like fantasy movies or doesn't like sci-fi or things like that, that kind of like, they'd say, well, why don't you just drive away? And he can't. You know, it's like, I kind of love that, though, that it's got that like kind of really great sort of, you know, because like, say, even like, say, again, I know that's the sign of another really great film that, like, say, a film like, say, Duel, the Spielberg film, or say A Dawn of the Dead, which I mentioned earlier on there, if it makes you think, what would I, that shot there's a very similar shot, I think, in Plan 9, I'm sure of it, again, so yeah, side by side comparisons, like, I wish I this never do it. yeah, that sort of, if it makes you think, what would I do in that situation? And like, say, when he gets to the motel later on, and you know, the manuscript's there, and he burns it, and then, and again, it's like, really by rights, I should hate this film, because it's kind of like, I would deliberately just sort of be interesting, just do a pause on that crowd scene there. It's just like a couple of just quite ordinary looking people. That'd be funny if it's like John Carpenter and loads of people. yeah, but when he gets to like the motel, and he's got the manuscript and he burns it, then when he gets to like the agent's office, like Charles Neston's character, and you know, it's like, when you brought me the manuscript months ago, it's kind of like, again, it's got this kind of like sort of you know, sort of playfulness to it, that like again, that like, say, really by rat, and again, I can see why this film would annoy somebody, that like, because like I say, if you're taking this as a straight linear movie, it doesn't make any sense. But and then again, like I say, I've seen this film more times than I've ever should have done, probably in the last 2 weeks. But it's kind of like, even if you look at it for him, he's crazy, or it's the boot doing it and things like that, it doesn't really make a lot of sense at all, full stop. But it's got that, like I say, it's got that, it's so loaded into it, so built in, that like, I kind of love it from, like I say, again, from like a technical writing exercise. If you literally did it as just like a writing test, to sort of, even if you thought like, no, you got to this film and someone give you the real script and said, you've got to work on this film and sort of figure out what, how to get him out of this situation, or to make it quote unquote realistic. I think it's so built into it now, it's so got to such a point that unless you fundamentally change the script, it's so cleverly done that it's like, I don't think you could literally get to this point there now and just like say, unless it was just like, yeah, it's a dream. But like I say, I love the thought of it just being, and it made me look at it just like say, literally in the last like say 5-10 minutes, it just literally made me look at it in a completely different way, that is, it's like, it's just a great, you know, like looking at it from the internal logic of the film, from like, as if it's like, the idea of it just being a book about this is like a completely separate entity, like, you know, because that is what this film's about. But again, it's that like, kind of loaded quality that like I kind of love about like films that like, and again, I must have said this on loads of commentaries, but like say, films like say Psycho 1998 and things like that, I love films where you can watch it over and over and over again. And if you've got that kind of mindset, and that's the thing, like, I think, say, with all this quote-unquote controversy about the new Ghostbusters film, and it's kind of made me lose the little tiny bit of respect I had for film fans, online film fans, I should say, not real, genuine film fans, but, like, because you can't have a discussion there with anybody about film, it's just, I think it's the best film ever, I think it's the worst film ever, and if you don't fall into those two camps, it's like, oh, okay. And like, and that's the one thing I've always loved about film, and the genuine film fans that are known in real life, they're, even if the very few films I don't like or the films they don't like, you can nearly always like have a discussion with them and go, well, I think it's this, I think it's that, and you know, like, you know, I'm probably, you know, for, you know, I've lived for another 50 years, I'll be still talking about Jaws of Revenge and Psycho 1998 and Godzilla 1998 and things like that. But yeah, say a film like this, though, I think that's the great thing about this film, is that you can literally look at it a million different ways, you know. gosh, let's get the munchies. I've got a Wright's pie to have anyway. Oof. Local delicacy. And yours, well. But again, as well, this is, I always think, the sign of a really good film, that, like, we're so close to the end of the film now, and it's kind of like, was like an hour and 10 minutes into it, and I feel like I've been talking for 15 minutes or something like that, and it's like, you know, four or five times out of moment, it's like, that's crazy. And like I say, again, like, just sort of, and I've mentioned it right at the very start, but sort of how sort of the idea is so great that, like, he's wrote this story that he is in. And, like, so he, in theory, why is he writing it, you know, in the sense that, like, he's obviously, if you, and again, you know, it makes you think in such a weird way that you've got to think, why is he, oh, you've got to write it good so it's a good story that people will buy. But then it's so ridiculous, because if he's writing the story, why did he just write, oh, the monsters come out from hell, the world's ended, and, you know, it makes you think, like, I know it's, again, a cliche, you know, outside the box and things like that, but it does make you sort of, you go, what? Like, and in a way, I'm surprised as many people like this film as they do, when, like, say, I mean, I know, like, I've got these out there film theories and things, and a few people, like, you know, like, say, people at college and things like that, they're like, they'll say, oh, remember when we were talking about, you know, some weird film theory and things like that, that, like, sort of, like, I say, instantly, like I said earlier on, this film just punches all my buttons. Like I say, John Carpenter, rock soundtrack, payphone, spoken, you know, all these different things, you know, like, people, you know, people from Star Wars, the words on it, Jürgen Prochnow, so, and then it's like such a mental film. So, like I say, I don't think I could, you know, probably not like this film so much. I could barely costume design a film any better. I think that's like CG there. That, and that's, again, I love it. You can read the actual, again, I don't think you can read this text on the VHS version as much as I like VHS, but that's great, that is. Yeah, so I kind of like this film, and I can see why I like it instantly. But I, you know, the fact that it, you know, it's done any business at all, really, is kind of phenomenal, really. But that's another thing, though, as well. Like, say, and, you know, like, say, you know, when you look at things from, like, when you know a little bit of the behind the scenes, but something like, I say, Michael De Luca, how he's, like, really powerful, like, businessman. You'd almost think that, like, that, I don't know, because, like, that's another thing, though, as well, because I've got, like, the VHS, I've got the Laserdisc, I've got the soundtrack on CD, but it's never been released on, like, DVD in the UK, and I don't think the Blu-ray's been released in the UK, and I don't think this film's on Netflix. But you'd almost think that, like, and probably, well, I'll never be a successful businessman, but you think this film would be, like, everywhere. You think it'd be, like, you know, think, like, you know, make all these deals, so it was, like, you know, it was, like, on Netflix and all these different things. But again, I think we said this on, like, quite a few commentaries, but, like, the mid-90s was this great period, like RoboCop 2 did it, and it was such a great mix of stop-motion, model, CG, shooting on film, like, you know, like, released on film, but this great mix of, it was, like, everything all at once, you know. That reminds me of Hellraiser for a little bit. I think I've seen the Hellraiser 2 similar to this, I think. I've seen that film for a long time. Again, I saw that at the same place where I saw They Live. That's weird. I'm coincidence man. God, that sounds like a rubbish superhero.
I was watching this the other day. I thought this scene was brilliant because Aiden Christensen on the bike, and there's like where you can barely reach the floor from on the bike, and you think, well, not that long after this guy was, there's Darth Vader right there. I mean, that's awesome. But what's really funny though, because, and I'm terrible for stuff like this, that like, I don't know if his name was in the credits, I don't think I'd ever would have, and it's one of them things where it's took me a long time to really sort of even, because normally I'm terrible for stuff like that, that like, I'll be like, oh, there's the guy from On the Buzzies, or there's the guy, there's that guy from, and I, so like, I, you know, like I'm an actor's worst nightmare, where I'm like, oh, remember when you were in that film you made 15 years ago, but like I never really, until really recently, consciously think that like, oh, there's a guy from Star Wars. Like that, he can't be, that's so funny. Well, so funny, it's slightly interesting. But again, that place there, it just feels so real. Like, you know, they probably just did just, I don't know, the location scouted, I don't know, but like, it just feels like a genuinely legitimate place, like a location and things, and then you've got all these fantastical, you know, creatures and monsters, and like you think they're like, there he's just like, you know, and they kind of reminded me of the road from the start of Big Trouble in Little China a little bit. Like, I almost reminded me that could be you know, the Pork Chop Express. That I meant to chat that company actually, we free TSS. And again, talking about like Psycho 1998, and I remember Gus Van Sant saying when he looked at the model for the motel, that all motels look the same. And again, you know, and they're like watching like a black and white film on a TV. Again, it's got that loaded element to it that like you know, you think the motel, you've seen a million motels in films, and you know, it always kind of makes me laugh that even in relatively new films, you'll see somebody watching like a black and white film on TV. And you know, even I love black and white films, and I don't really watch that many black and white films on TV, and especially don't see them on TV very often. So it's always again, it's playing into that like kind of no checks accepted. So it's called CH, not CEQUE. I like that phone there, I never noticed that phone before. Don't be a shit. But that's again, like I say, that USA Today paper there, if that was a real issue of that paper. I'm not sure, but again, I can't, and it's like there, like obviously he's been through quite a lot, so he's probably not, if you took this as like a linear film, like a normal concept, that like in the sense that like somebody had theoretically dropped off that manuscript, I don't know what manuscript actually means, but he's dropped, you know, somewhere he's dropped that off. I want you to try and read that dialogue that the writing there on that sign in that frame just by the door. But yeah, so in theory, again, providing he's not insane and just imagined all this, somebody dropped that off. Who dropped it off? You know, and again, it's got that like kind of, and I've said it 5,000 times already, but like how that just does sort of, well, you think, well, you know, look at that cool cigarette light though. I never really ever noticed it before. That looks like a proper, again, it's got that believability to it that like, you know, if you've ever been on like a National Express bus, or I think they have ground buses in America and stuff, that like, this is kind of what it's like. The Jack Reacher thing again, it's like the end of Jack Reacher. Trent Way Wager, I think it said on the buzz. I'll have to pause that later and try first see if that's a real buzz company. The old lady was such a game. And that's one thing that's great as well. I mean, you know, I've said this before on commentaries, but, and I kind of think it's true, kind of think it's not true, but when you get like, again, real filmmakers, and they'll have smoking in a film, or they'll have like, you know, like you say something like a Tom Atkins or something, and like, you know, The Fog or something like that. But I feel like, you know, these are real people, you know, and it's again a cliche thing to say, like, you know, but I feel like, you know, Sam Neill's just like, he looks like, you know, he looks like a movie star, but like Jürgen Prochnow, they feel like, you know, that like if this was made by not as brave a filmmaker. They'd have like, you know, some like, you know, heartthrob on there or something. But like, it's ridiculous thing to say when like Sam Neill was nearly James Bond, so he's obviously pretty good looking. I've thought sometimes that when sometimes if I ever am in a situation, like, it doesn't happen very often, Leo, touch wood, this is reality, like, if I'm in a situation where, like, say I'm in some business or I'm trying to argue the toss in some kind of company or something, I sometimes feel like this, like, it's like, get me a supervisor. I sometimes think of this scene. Do you find women walking through the door? It's okay. 1 hour, 20 minutes before I've said that. And again, this is, like, say, this great, that payphone in the background as well. It's not the same company there. It's in the same town. Yeah, there, like, there was a computer there on the desk, but, like, he's walking down the street and there's a payphone. I guess there's still payphones knocking around. Well, I used to payphone yesterday, funny enough. Living the now. Yeah, I used to payphone yesterday, it's pretty cool. And again, like, they're just, and this is a really funny thing, and again, this is just particular to me, I feel like nobody else has ever mentioned it, but I really like when you can sort of, to me, looking out that window, it feels like a 90s film. Like, sometimes you'll see, like, the sky in an 80s film, or, like, you know, a building, and just, I don't know if it's, like, the film stock, or the way the film's aged, or it's just purely my imagination, but this feels like a 90s, just the scene here feels 90s to me. And I know the real reason why. Oh, Charlton Heston. He was in Planet of the Apes, which I was talking about the other day. Coincidence man strikes again. But then this is that thing as well, like, say, looking at it from, you know, you can only look at it when you can only come up with these things where you've seen it a million times, but like, there, why is this meeting even happening if the book's been published? There, why would it be like, I'm coming in to talk to you about that manuscript that went missing? Yeah, I know you did, because the book's already. So it's kind of like, again, it's kind of like, you know, you have to sort of take it with a grain of salt, or you have to read into it slightly differently. No pun intended, you have to read into it slightly differently, and that, like, if In the Mouth of Madness, the book is really out there, and if there's a film coming out with, like, in the next week, and obviously if you're keyed into that situation and you've been into this arcane stuff and things like that, that you would surely have seen posters or gone in a bookshop and seen it there. I still thought, well, that scene where he was trying to find out where upside down, what the hell was that building? Was that like a library? But that, and that's it again though, but the brilliantness of the script is that, like, there, he says, have you read the book? No. Like, I can't read them because they make me feel ill. Brilliant. Like, again, but that like, this scene really doesn't make any sense at all. And then you've got that great, like, kind of punchline to it all, that, like, sort of sting in the tail that, like, oh, well, why is it there? The turkey wing leg? Oh, turkey wiggle leg? I thought it said at first. Now, Sutter Cane. And I mean, that'd be such a great standee. Have, like I said, I saw somebody on eBay selling the books, but that'd be so cool to have that standee. It'd be awesome. But I wonder if Samuel's got that in his house. Just trying to see what they don't look like the same page, actually, funny enough. Well, I think it's two separate pages, though. I think it looked slightly different because I think the text at the very top of the pages was on different on each side. So I thought about this yesterday as well. Thought that'd be a great Halloween costume to go as, like, just get like some pajamas or overalls, drawing those black crosses on like that, and like, I'd love to know if anybody knew what the hell you were doing. Like, you know, again, like, say, so we said, you John Trent? We're like, yeah, high five. See you later. That was nothing. I'm surprised I wasn't laughing when I first started the commentary, because I do like little tests just before, and just make sure the equipment's working. Just do like a little 30-second or 15-second like just recording, and I said, "Yeah, in the Method Man, that's fan commentary. See you later." And I don't know why, just like crap me up. Oh, David Warner. But again, it's like a David Warner where he was in Planet of the Apes as well. Oh my god, it's all coincidence, man. Another adventure. But yes, when like a David Warner. This film is like, say, loaded with like, you know, like so much sort of stuff is either deliberately put in there, or even like, you know, like say, you know, David Warner, because he's been in so many films. If you check David Warner's IMDb page, it's unbelievable. He's been like The Omen, Tron, Doctor Who, you know, like let's say Planet of the Apes remake and stuff like that. So even if you don't know who David Warner is, you've probably seen him in like 4 or 5 movies at least. And then like seems like a Sam Neill, I say he was very nearly James Bond. He's been in like Dead Calm, he's been in things like this, Jurassic Park, and you know, that's the guy from like Gremlins 2. He's got the bad guy, you know, Vigo from Ghostbusters 2. You've got Jürgen Prochnow in there from Beverly Hills Cop 2. And they're these names that like they might not be like, say, you know, say that recognition of someone like, say, a Tom Cruise or something. Obviously Charlton Heston has, but like, you know, just generally, like say like Bernie Casey, who's like Felix Leiter. I can't remember the names of any Bernie Casey cases, that, but he's been in like things like I'm Gonna Get You Sucker, and like say he was Felix Leiter in Never Say Never Again, and that. So you've got all this stuff that like, even if you haven't seen these people, you've seen these people, like, you know what I mean? And you've got the great Carpenter thing in a minute, like he did it in, think Escape from New York and at least a couple of other films, but when the character goes past the foreground of the and there's like a there's like a great keyboard sound just there, and it's like, oh, that's great. Again, it's got that, but it's got like that Carpenter trademarkness to it, but at the same time it doesn't feel like, you know, some things that, like, if you see, like, the wipes in Star Wars and things like that, they do have in Force Awakens, I'm sure they must have. But, yeah, if you see, like, the wipes in Star Wars, it's instantly like, Star Wars, you know, but like something like this. It's like, now that you've seen, like, tons of John Carpenter stuff, it'll just be, oh, okay, you know, it'll just be a thing. But, like, it feels like it's in some John Carpenter universe, some John Carpenter world, but without really, oh, like say he was in Memoirs of an Invisible Man. It's got that, like say, it's got that, it's just so multi-layered, it's unbelievable. I never really noticed the door before, like as if it'd been sort of like what was going on just. But again, though, this is that thing. I know it doesn't say to anybody, but like, say you've got the two ways of looking at it: that this is real, or this is all this imagination. But if it isn't real, well, who did that? Like, you know, and then so. But then, if it is real, that sort of, well, it's real. So it's kind of like. But I think, like I said before, I've kind of, in like, say, sometimes when I've, like, say, posted about it on all the forums and stuff, and, like, people are like, what the hell are you on about, like, kind of thing, about, like I'll come up with some insane theory about something, you know, or some weird way of looking at it, but I really love films like this, and, like, say, Total Recall's another example, and things like that, where I love even the way people come up with theories or come up with ideas for things, because sometimes, you know, you'll just read something, oh, that's perfect. I never would have thought of looking at it like that. There's the computer and the switchboard. Okay, such a weird disk drive or something. But again, that's like, say, these great sort of, you know, the great visual style it's got like there. Like when you saw it at the start and it was all really clean, and you saw all the things behind those desks where they could pump the music into the rooms and stuff. Like there, that just feels like there to me, just the way that sky looks and everything there,
it just felt like that's what it was like when I left the cinema, you know, like that's what the sky looked like. What were the skies like when you were in the 90s? And there was a cinema at the time, not the cinema I saw the cinema, but there was a cinema just down the road from the other cinema. The two cinemas that went to my hometown, there was one cinema, the Animal Key, nowhere near that cool, but like the Animal Key similar to that. Sutter Cane's in the middle. That's interesting. Never saw it said Sutter Cane at the top of the. And that's great there, like written by Michael DeLuca and John Carpenter and stuff like that. And that's brilliant. I mean, but one thing as well about that, I like that doorway does down the distance at the right. That kind of almost looks like the cinema I saw it up. But this is a brilliant piece of acting here. It literally took me a good 30 times before I noticed just how perfect it was. But how he starts watching the film and he's like laughing and then he starts crying. I mean, it's like. Again, you know, somebody said to me, "What, you know, some of the best acting you've ever seen," and it's like, you know, this little, like, again, cut this down to a minute, and it's like, you know, it's like, is this reality? But that's another thing in Omega Man, the Charlton Heston film, when he goes in the cinema there and he watches his own, he watches the, you know, the Woodstock film and stuff. I mean, this is great. And look at this, though, his emotion changes. That is brilliant. And that's so great. I know, like Oscars very rarely go to, like, horror films and stuff, but, jeez, man, he definitely deserved an Oscar for that. And like I say, Frances Bay, rest in peace. Oh, she was a nice old lady. Des O'Connor. Dennis O'Connor. Aiden Christensen is Paperboy. Yeah, but I mean, I feel like that, like, I don't feel like I've just done a 94-minute movie, you know, that's crazy. Kyle Sheeran. I was thinking of Ed Sheeran. Kevin, that's another thing as well, I noticed, only noticed this the other day, like, there was two people with the last surname, Zegers, I think it was, Jeff and Marjorie, who's worked on loads of films as well, but loads of people on this have got, like, two people with the same name, and that Weatherwax, that's the guy that trained the dog from The Thing, and Lassie. I'm sure you see dog trainer, it's Weatherwax. Yeah, but you see loads of people in these crates with the same second name, and I only noticed it like the other day. I was like, oh. And now there's not going to be another example of it. I was like, let me see nicknames in credits. But that's another thing though as well. I think I might have mentioned on the last couple of commentaries, but when you'll see like the credits have been made by a completely separate company. But surely though, like if you're good enough to do like the visual effects, why not just say, okay, you're knocking me out of credit reel as well? Like, you know, I'm sure there's a, sure the Cody, oh yeah, they're Cody Carpenter and Daniel Davis. Are they the, they're his band at the moment and got tickets to go see him live. Yeah, the dog trainer's Rudel Weatherwax. Weatherwax is the Lassie guys. Production control. And because I'm so used to reading the soundtrack as well, it sounds so great through headphones. Like there's that track where John Trent's walking around and that Carpenter score there is incredible. G Savoy, I went to check that guy. This is going to be my random crew member, G Savoy. You got no first, just, are you spelling your first name? Just the letter G? I think Waltorska did Escape from Ali, I think. Special effects by Industrial Light and Magic, Lucasfilm, again, look at that, it's like, it's all there if you're into the computer graphics. Well, that's what I was watching Basil this morning, and I love how like this computer graphics in it, there's like two people that did it, and you fast forward like, you know, 8 years and nothing's changed, two people doing the computers. KNBEFX. I don't know why I love the credits so much. It's like, credits are so relaxing. Now I've made a beer last the whole movie. Well, I then have one and a bit cans, does up his head. Well, if you call a mouthful part of a can. Ooh. Mark DeLuca, yeah, there's somebody there. Maybe no relation, I'm not sure. Weddington Productions.
good pasty. Oh, that's, oh, the editor's good pasty. That's funny if they cut and pasty. Negative cutter. Music recording, no world. Still funny. Product placement. What the hell was the product placement? I guess the car, maybe. Panavision Canada. That's a real company. Just kidding. I don't know why, that little list just sounded funny to me. It's like, there's a Pinewood Studios, like, in another country, and I was like, Robot Monster, we've only just begun. Doesn't say by the Carpenters. Like, was it just because people... They played a little bit of the Carpenters one, didn't they? That's always a credit that gets noticed. That's a famous one. Casualties Heavy and Interplanetary Association, DTS. I always thought DTS and all were the same thing until we see 32,000. There you go. Hope you enjoyed the In the Mouth of Madness fan commentary, and see you later.